So the last time what we were discussing was the derivation for Xavier initialization, which we had already done. So what we have seen was, like, in order to have a same variance in these nodes, the ones which we have discussed here, in order to have same variance of these nodes like that of the feature nodes, like this one, in order to have these variations to be same, what we deduced was during this derivation, that the variance of the W's that you will initialize in this neural network will be having a value of 1 by n. So that is important. So you want the variance of the weights that you will be initializing to have a value of 1 by n. Then we saw that if we, take a random variable Z, and we are sam if we sample it from a Gaussian distribution having zero mean and unit variance, and if we scale it by 1 by root n, then it is same as what you are doing in when you substitute all these values, like the random variable z divided by root n into this expression, then it will evaluate to a value of 1, which is this one. So this is already, n times variance of w is equal to 1, which we had already started with. And how we reached from variance of z root 1 to this expression is by using this expression here. So variance of a times z is actually a square times variance of z. So using that, we achieved this result here. So from here, what we have seen is, even in our earlier discussion, we saw that the variance of W is equal to 1 by n means, and here n is basically the number of neurons which are fan in. Fan in means how many number of connections which are getting into the node. So you have this node here, right? We already discussed. This node is, let us consider this node as a hidden node of a neural network. So fan in means how many connections are moving into this node. So that is basically fan in. So in this derivation, we have seen that the variance of W, if it is 1 by n, then this n is actually fan in. And so this we have already discussed in our last lecture also. So Xavier initialization is basically what you are doing is you are initializing from a normal distribution having zero mean and variance 1 by n. So in Python, when you write something like this, like you have this expression, right? np.random.rand. So basically, you are actually doing a dist you are actually sampling the random variable from this distribution, which is of zero mean and unit variance. And when you multiply this with 1 by root n, so when you multiply this with 1 by root n is actually effectively doing this type of distribution. So it's ex converting it into a distribution which is n of 0 mean and 1 by n. So this is very important. So why you are scaling it by 1 by root n, you now know, because what you are doing is you are actually taking a random variable from the distribution which is a Gaussian distribution, and this we are calling it as z, and then you are scaling it by 1 by root n. So what effectively you are doing is you are actually implementing Xavier initialization, where we have done this derivation in details. So now you know why we are, appending this 1 by root n. And the reason for that is to have a same Gaussian distribution in the hidden nodes as in the input nodes. Later on, one more researcher, Glorot and Bengio, what they have realized is it's not 1 by root n. It is basically 1 by root n in plus n out. And this n out is basically coming because of the back propagation that you do in the neural networks. See, the n in is coming because we have implemented a forward propagation neural network, but we didn't consider the back propagation neural network, like we didn't back propagated the errors. So n out is basically coming because of the back propagation effect. So what is n out? N out is basically the number of nodes that are moving out of this particular node. So this will be your N out, and this is your N in. And this N in was considered or was coming because you are doing forward propagation only. But when you are considering back propagation also, then N out will be started to play its role. So the researchers, these researchers have found that back propagation is also important, and when they derived their results, you can find that in this paper. If you want, you can go to this paper and check, like, how they have derived this expression. So in this paper, you will find that when they did the back propagation thing, then they realized that it's basically n in plus n out, and they are taking a harmonic mean of this. So it's basically a 2 divided by n in plus n out. So this is the derivation that you can find it in this paper. So when you do something like this, which is given over here, then you are doing a Glorot and Baggio's initialization, which in short we say also like Glorot initialization. So the basic aim of both these initialization is to make the distribution in the hidden nodes look like Gaussian. So when I ran this experiment here again, you see in our earlier experiment when we were showing you this results here, what I was taking is the value of W, I was taking it as very small like this. I was scaling it by 0.01, and then you saw that all these hidden nodes were having very less variance in less distribution. It was not that good distribution, you know, it was completely gone. It's a spike only. So then we realized there is something, some problem here. So then we derived all these expressions, and once we got these results which I am showing you here, then what I am doing is I am again using this W, which is a random RN, this thing, and then I am scaling it by 1 by root n in. This is the Xavier initialization which you are doing normally. So when you do that, now you can see the hidden nodes. These are the hidden nodes distribution. So now you can see how these distributions have become Gaussian. Earlier it was a single spike. So now when they have become Gaussian and there is an enough variance here, you can see now the variance is now visible. Earlier the variance was not there in these distributions, but now the variance is visible. So when the variance is visible, then as we discussed last time also, that these hidden nodes will now start learning the features. Earlier they were learning same features, but now because of the distribution of the variance across this Gaussian, now these features will be they will run variety of the features, and they will be more expressive. In earlier case they were not expressive at all. So using this Xavier initialization, we were able to achieve this. And please note, what I am doing here is I am using a 10 hyperbolic nonlinearity in all these hidden layers. The experiment that we started with, like, you know, this is the experiment that we started with. As you realize, I just recall it back. This is the experiment that we started with, right? So each of the hidden layers that I am using 10 hyperbolic nonlinearity here. So that is the case for this experiment. Now again, I ran this experiment with sigmoid nonlinearity, as you can see here, and same Xavier initialization. So now again you can see here the distribution is having some variance, and you can see it for all the other nodes also. Now again, what I have done is, using 10 hyperbolic, I used Glorot initialization, which we already discussed. So using that also, you will get some distribution, and what I have found is the sigma, the variation in this Gaussian distribution, is not that it's somewhat similar to what we have obtained for the case of this one for the Xavier initialization, but the difference is not that much. If you observe the sigma value here, the value of the sigma is not that different. But still, what they have said is, like, you know, you have to include n out because of the back propagation thing. So that's why I ran this experiment and saw this. And this is for Glorot initialization in case of sigmoid units. Now important thing is, if I initialize, or if I use ReLU activation unit in the hidden layers, and if I use this initialization, which is the first one. So when I initialize the ReLU activation with this initialization, it generates the same curve with 10 hyperbolic nonlinearity, but with W equal to this. So when we ran this experiment where the nonlinearity used was 10 hyperbolic and this one, this weight, which was a very small weight. So what I observed is, when I was running ReLU with this initialization, the Xavier initialization, I was getting the same results as I was getting when 10 hyperbolic was initialized with small number of weights, that is W. So to solve this problem, what we have done is, what the researchers basically have done is, they have actually used red n divided by root of n by 2. So they have scaled it by the value of root 2. So when I scaled this value by root 2, then we started getting good distribution. You know, this is the distribution that we are getting in the hidden nodes. So the only thing that we have done is we have scaled it by 2 here, the variance. And this is called as he initialization. You can look into that paper also. I have not listed out it here, but this is the he initialization, Camming and he. So what they have done is they have scaled it by 2. And the reason for doing that is, as you know, that the ReLU activation unit is something like this, you know. So some part, this part is completely zero, and this is actually, you know, it's throwing out values here. So to compensate with this part, which is completely zero, what they have done is they have increased the factor. They have included this two factor to boost this loss, which is actually completely zero here. So in order to boost this particular region, which is completely zero, they have accommodated that loss by, you know, increasing the variance twice. So that's why when I ran it by, you know, root of 2 by n, then we got significant variance, which was not the case when we ran it by root n. So if you have any doubts, please let me know in this particular topic of weight initialization. Okay, so now the next topic that we want to discuss is data augmentation. So in data augmentation, what is data augmentation? It's a data processing step that increases the amount of available samples by performing some transformations on the original data. So if the data is very less, in some situations we have some less data, so what we do is we do some transformations on the data to generate some more data, so that, you know, we can have enough data to train the neural networks. So the challenge for doing this type of data augmentation technique is that the transformation should preserve the original labels or annotations of the data. So this is the challenge. So can anybody tell me, like, what this challenge is all about? Like, can you give me an example where, you know, you will do some data augmentation and it will fail? Normally we do it randomly, you know, by calling TensorFlow program, like, you know, TensorFlow function, you call that data augmentation and you do it randomly. But can you give me an example where you perform a data augmentation and, you know, it will give you some, you know, some image which is not the exact image that you wanted to do, you wanted to generate? Can you give me one example for that? Any one of you? Okay, so let us say if you have an image 6 here, and if you do a rotation type of thing on this particular image, what it will become? It will become 9. So the labels are completely changed. You were actually doing, you know, data augmentation for this image, which is 6, but now when you did a rotation type of transformation on this image, it became 9 now. So now even the labels are also changed, but you are actually training this particular neural network for 6. You are saying this image is also 6, because internally what you are doing is you are actually doing a transformation, but you thought that all these images will be 6. But here in this case, it's a problem. So you have to, even doing after the data augmentation, you have to see whether your data set is actually preserving the originality of the data or not, because here the original image is 6, which is converted to 9 during the transformation. Okay, so why data augmentation? That is important. As we already discussed earlier also, it will improve the performance of the machine framework if lot of data is improved. If the lot of data is included, then the performance will be improved. And the second thing is, it teaches the model about the invariance in the data domain. It's also important. You know, what you do is normally if you have some image like six here, and if you translate these images or rotate these images, then the model will become adaptive to the invariances. Like, you know, this will be treated as six. Again, if you shift it to this side, it will be also treated as six. So the invariance means you are if a model is moved towards horizontal, vertical sides, actually, you know, it will still detect it as six. So it will the data augmentation is somehow or the other, you know, helping you to teach the model about the invariance. And this we have already discussed in greater details, like it will also reduce overfitting. We have seen it in through the learning curves that how if you increase the data, it will reduce overfitting. The common image transformation schemes that you use in data augmentation are horizontal flip, vertical flip, zoom or crop the image, you shear the stress, you know, you make this images something like this. If you have this image, you will make it something like this, this type of transformation. You are shearing it in X direction. So you can, you know, you can do this type of transformation. You can translate, you can rotate, you can invert, adjust, color balance, brightness and sharpness. And there are many more. So these are the common type of transformations that you will do in data augmentation schemes. So let us discuss some of the transformations in form of the images. Let me, you know, make it normal. So as you can see here, we have a tennis ball. So what we are doing here is we are doing an image translation scheme in this side. We are translating the images and we are creating a bunch of we are creating a data augmentation of this particular image. This is image flipping. This I have taken from nanonets.com. So if you want, you can see from there how they are, you know, they have written a very good blog on this. So this is basically, you know, doing a image flipping. This is doing a rotation. So it's creating a rotation of images here. This is a scaling operation that is performed on the images. This is cropping, where the cropping is done on a particular portion of the image and then it's resized. So it's a cropping operation which is performed. Then we have Gaussian noise also. So people are adding noise into it. And you can see these are the noisy images here. So you can add noise also, small type of noise. So that also makes you know, neural network robust to noise transformations. And then again we have something like rotation. So you have this image rotated and translated to the right and scaled inwards. So one thing to note here is when you do something like this, like when you rotate the image, when you translate it to the right, or you do something like invert transformation, what you observe is that some of the pixels here, you know, in this side are completely black. These are black, they are all black. So this is very important, you know, you have to look into these things also. When you do something like this, like, you know, when you rotate the image or translate or scale, what you observe is some of the borders will become zero. They will, this type of transformation will fill the values here to be zero. So what you have to do is you have to fill these borders so that the image should look complete. So in order to do that, what you do is you do something like this, you know, you do a constant, you do a edge, you do a reflection, you do a symmetric, or you do a wrapping operation around the boundaries. So this you can look into image processing literature also. I don't know whether you have gone through that course, but in when you go through that course of image processing, you will see there are some boundary conditions which we call as reflective boundary conditions, symmetric boundary conditions, wrapping of the boundary conditions. So using these type of boundary conditions, you can make these images to overcome these artifacts which I am showing you here. These are the black ones, these are the artifacts. So as you can see, if you fill these images by a constant value of, let us say, 10, so you can see now though the artifact is very prominent, but it has all, you know, it has a constant value of some 10 here and it's not zero. So this is filling up the boundary by a constant values. The other one is edge. As you can see, whatever is there in this at this boundary, it is, you know, it is copying it over to these boundaries. So these type of things, these type of transformations, you can look into details in the manuals of TensorFlow, like how they are doing this. See here also, you can see now how this boundary is filled using the wrapping of the pixels at the boundary location. And same here also, this is not you can see here, this is completely, you know, there is no what you say, this one is completely looking like, you know, there is no artifact here. It's completely, you know, smooth by using the symmetric boundary conditions. Here also you can see it's completely smooth. And why? Because we are using symmetric boundary conditions here. So if you want to learn more about this, you can see, you know, some of the manuals of TensorFlow and Python for image processing. Okay, so the last one, what we call is early stopping. I think most of you must be knowing it. So what is this early stopping doing is, it is actually trying to prevent the models from overfitting. So what you do is, if you have a, you know, loss, if you run your training and the validation loss, so your training loss is something like this and your validation loss is, you know, something like this. So what you do is, you try to stop your model the moment it starts going up. So the moment it starts going up, you stop it here itself. So this type of phenomena is called as early stopping, and it will, you know, it helps in reducing the overfitting problem. So because, you know, as the loss will increase, here you are entering in the overfitting region. So by truncating your simulations here itself, which we call as early stopping, you are actually preventing your model to become overfit. So this is actually early stopping thing that I think most of you know that. And you can use you know, inbuilt early stopping function in TensorFlow to stop your model at this particular point. Okay, so today actually we have finished, I think, most of the topics related to hyperparameter optimizations. So the next topic that we will discuss today is optimizations, the schemes that we are using to do the back propagation. So as you all know that we perform back propagation, and that is done through some of the existing optimizers. So we will be discussing them gradually, and we will move from a very simple optimizer which we know as gradient descent till ADAM, and we will see that what is the motivation behind, you know, getting to that sophisticated model which is ADAM. And we will not jump straight forward, they bring up the story, and we will see what are the drawbacks and how other researchers have removed that drawbacks and moved forward till the ADAM optimizer, which is the current state of the art optimizer that most of us use. So let me discuss this now. So as all of you know that this is the gradient descent, a well known gradient descent which you must be using, I think, from a long time. Even in your machine learning course also you must have encountered this. So what we have is, in gradient descent we have this loss function. So this GW is basically defining the loss function for your problem. And what you are doing is, you are actually updating the weights WK as WK minus 1, the earlier weight, minus alpha times the gradient of this loss function evaluated at WK minus 1. So this is important. So if the current value of the weight WK will be evaluated when you do the gradient on the earlier weight. So you have to calculate the gradient at the earlier weight and then scale it with alpha, which is the learning parameter. Then you will be getting the newer weight here, WK. So in this case, as you can see in this figure, the gradient at this point, this is actually, you can say, WK minus 1. So here the gradient is negative. So when the gradient is negative, this term will become positive, because this is the gradient which is negative. So when this term becomes positive, for a constant value of alpha with the old weights of wk minus 1, which is here, you know, this is wk minus 1. So you are adding something, you are adding now because the gradient is negative. So when you add something, you move to the new point, which is wk. So this is your new weight, which is wk here. So in this case, k is 1. So this is a basic idea of gradient descent, which all of you must be knowing it. So let us discuss the details of the gradient descent more. So in the next slide, what I am showing you here is the contour plots. So let's discuss briefly about what is contour plot, what are its properties, so that later on when we will discuss advanced architectures, then you will not feel uncomfortable in understanding that. So what I am doing here is I have plotted a three-dimensional function, which is this one. As you all know, this is a convex function because it has a global minima. There is no local minima here. It's a convex function. We have discussed convex functions slightly in our earlier lectures also. You can look at that if you have any confusion. So this is a convex function because it has a global minima. So as you can see here, this is the actual function that we have plotted here. This is z, this is x, and this is y. So if you want to realize this three-dimensional function on a two-dimensional plane, so then how will you do that? You will do it by actually, drawing a plane here. If you draw a horizontal plane here, and if you look from bottom, it's a projection actually. You are seeing from bottom. Sometimes some people say like from the top you are seeing, but in this case I am seeing it from bottom. So if I am seeing it from bottom, and I am cutting this at a particular location here with this plane, then what we observe is ellipses. You can realize it in your mind also, you can visualize it. Like when you cut the plane, when you cut this particular, bowl shape function with a slice, with a plane here, then what you will get is a ellipse. So that ellipse is these ellipses. These are the ellipses that you will get when you do multiple slicing of this. So once if you do a slice here, then you will get a ellipse, which is the smallest ellipse over here. So as you do multiple slices of this bowl function, you will get multiple ellipses on the two-dimensional plane. So this is basically W1 and this, this is X, this is Y. So these are the concentric ellipses that you will get when you bisect this cost function, which is given over here. And what is the important property of these, contour plots? The important property is, there are two important properties. The first property is, if you have, these contour lines, these are the contour lines. If these contour lines are close to each other, if they are close to each other, then you can visualize it as the slope of the function is very high over here in this situation where the contour plots are very close to each other. So as you can see also that this particular region corresponds to this region here. So as the contour plots are very close to each other here, so that means you are saying that it has a very high slope. So that slope is, you can see over here also in three-dimensional plot. But as the distance between the contour plots increases, then you can say that we are entering into a low slopey region, and the slope is not that much. So the closer the contours, the closer the ellipses boundaries are, the high slope it will have in the loss function. But if the contour boundaries are very far apart from each other, then that corresponds to a slow slope, very less slope in the 3D function. So that is the first property. And the second property is, all the values on this particular ellipse, like if I am selecting this ellipse, all the values here will be same. So this will have some value, let us say alpha, then this will have all the values same as beta. So all the values will be same for for each and individual ellipse. So these are the two important properties for contour plots. So this is again showing you a same bowl shape function, but it's not convex at all now because we have some local minimas here. You can see you have some, you know, local minimas created here, and you can see now the 2D projection of it here, and see the ellipses that are formed here, the deformed ellipses. They are not exactly ellipses now, it's a deformed ellipses. So now you can see here, so all these values along these ellipses for this particular ellipse will be same. But now one thing to realize here is that these contours here at this point are very close to each other, and for here also it's very close to each other, so that corresponds to very high slope in the 3D function. But here in this situation, the contour plots are far apart from each other, then you can say that the slope is not that much. So this is showing you one of the plots. This is the third plot that I am showing you. So now you can see it's a more complex function, and its contour plot is given here. And from this you can see there are multiple minimas here. You can see this is the one, this is one minima, this is another minima, this is the third minima, this is the fourth. So there are multiple minimas here, which is very difficult to visualize here. And also the distancing between the contour plots shows you the gradients information, like what kind of slope it has. So any doubts related to the contour plots? If anyone has any doubts, please let me know, otherwise I will proceed. Okay, so in gradient descent,
is there any indication to which minima is like has a lower value than the other minima? Can that
influence? I think that one is difficult to visualize here in contour plots, like which minima will be more lower as compared to the other one. It is difficult.
Okay,
so in gradient descent, as you already know, one thing is important. Since the gradients are the vectors, so it will be associated with direction as well as the magnitude. So this is actually showing you that same story here, that the vector magnitude is this, and the direction it makes with the horizontal axis is this. So this is basically a high level overview of showing you the gradients with its magnitude and direction. So the important point, the third important point that I wanted to emphasize here is, these are the two points already I have discussed regarding the contour plots. The third important point is the direction of the gradients. So that is also important. So the direction, I'm showing you here these three contour plots. So from here you can see the direction of the gradients is always perpendicular to the contour map. So if you have, you know, this ellipse here, so the direction of the gradient will be always perpendicular to this. It will always be perpendicular, 90 degrees. So in purple, it will be 90 degrees. So it will always be like that. Same for this and same for this. You can see for each of these contour plots, the gradient direction will be always 90 degrees. And one more thing that I want to emphasize here is that, as you can see here in this situation, you can have multiple gradients, like, you know, this gradient is also possible, and this gradient, but what the software is showing you is to move in this direction. Can anybody tell me why this gradient is not selected, why this gradient is only selected by looking at these contour plots? Can anyone tell? We have these two gradient options, right? One is going to the left, another one is going to the right. The reason why this particular gradient is selected is, as you can see from the figure itself, the distance between these contour, these plots is less as compared to the distance between the two here. So if the distance between these two maps is less compared to this, that means the minima is on this side, and here the slope is not that great. That's why gradient is selecting this direction, because here the slope is high, here the slope is less. That's why it is moving in that direction. Okay, so one more thing, as you already know about this also, this is regarding alpha, that step length variation. So if you make your alpha less, that is 0.005, then it will take very tiny steps to reach the minima. But if you take a moderate alpha, then it will take some decent steps to reach the minima. But if you take extreme alpha, which is 1.2 or something like that, then you can see how minima is not achieved and your function will blow up, because you will not be able to get to the minima and you are actually blowing up your function, and you know all these weights, this is completely blown up. So there is no minima you are achieving here. So the reasonable value of alpha is required, that is important. So this is like, you know, you are doing something like overfitting here, you know, you are blowing up the function by taking large value of alpha, something like that. So this is showing you a typical variation that you have to take, you have to consider during the selection of the step length, which is learning rate also. And this is the corresponding cost function by selecting different values of alpha. Here you can see how the cost function is blowing up. Okay, so now you know all these things. You have understood the gradient descent in very details. You know, you must be working on this from, you know, from 2 to 3 years. Like, you know how to, you know every detail of gradient descent. So can anybody tell me what are the weaknesses of gradient descent? Because if there are no weaknesses, then there is no point in moving to ADAM and all that type of optimizers. So can anybody tell me what are the weaknesses of the gradient descent? Any one of you? Okay, so I'll tell you the weaknesses. The first weakness of the gradient descent, please note, it's very important. The first weakness of gradient descent is that the direction of the negative gradient actually oscillates during the running of the gradient descent, often producing a zigzag steps that takes considerable time to reach a minimum point. We will discuss this in more details once we go further, but please note, this is the first weakness that we have in gradient descent, that is zigzag behavior during the optimization process. And this is shown you over here, like, what is that exactly? So you can see here, I have plotted these three plots here. So these are the three plots that we have. So in these three plots, one thing that you can observe here is that zigzagging is happening. By zigzagging means like this, you know, I will show you in highlights. This type of phenomena is happening. It's a zigzag pattern that is happening over here. This is what I'm calling it as zigzag. So one thing to note here is that zigzag is happening in all the three cases, from first, second and third. So because of this zigzag behavior, it leads to slow convergence. By slow convergence means reaching to this optimal point minima, which is here, it is taking a lot of time because it can go straight like this. But now it is taking too much of time by going up and down and then reaching the minima. So this zigzagging actually leads to slow convergence problems. And in this situation where you see one thing which is very important, in this situation, the contour plots here are completely parallel. You can see these contour plots here. This is the first, this is the second contour plot, this is the third. They are completely parallel to each other. And the gradients will also become completely parallel to each other. You can see here, these are the gradients for this contour plot and these are the gradients for this contour plot. So they are completely opposite and parallel to each other. As a result of which, what is happening? The gradient descent is not moving at all. It is some way or the other stopping at this point and it's not going to the minimum point, which is here. So now you can see, if your contour plots are, you know, a wide ellipses like this, it's a wide ellipse. You can see here, they are wide ellipses. Then because of the horizontal situation, it is because of these curves are becoming horizontal at the extreme ends, the gradient descent will not reach to the minimum value. So this is another problem. That is, our gradients are becoming parallel to each other and are opposite. That's why this particular, in this particular situation, your optimizer is not going to the minima. So this is the problem. So zigzagging, that which we have discussed here, becomes more prominent. It becomes more prominent in case of mini batch gradient descent. So let us divert a bit to mini batch gradient descent. What mini batch gradient descent means, because we have not discussed it, and this mini batch gradient descent is the main culprit which creates zigzag behavior. So let us discuss why we need mini batch. Though it is producing zigzag behavior, then why we still require mini batch? So what is the reason behind it? We will discuss this, and once it's a slight diversion from the current state of the topic that we are discussing, but we will come back again to the original discussion about addressing this situation, which is this zigzag behavior. So let us discuss mini batch gradient descent and see why zigzagging is prominent here in this case. So if you have a X, which is the data set you have in your hand, and if you partition that data set into P parts by writing it like this, so you have X, which you are writing as summation running from P1 to P X. I am writing it in this fashion. So this means you are actually partitioning the complete X into P different parts, equal parts. So if you have this data set X, let us say, and if you have, you know, some, let us say 3000 points like this. Here you can see we have 3000 points, and this M is actually the features. Now you know that the convention that we are already using. So I am arranging it in a matrix having M cross 3000. So now can anybody tell me, if I want to do a gradient descent on these type of 3000 samples, let us assume it's not 3000, 3 millions, let us say 3 million samples, not 3000, but 3 millions. Then can anybody tell me what will be the drawback of this grade if I apply gradient descent here for this particular matrix having M features and 3 million samples? Anyone? I'm trying to give you a motivation why we are studying mini batch gradient descent, what's the reason behind it. So if can anybody tell me, like, what is the drawback if I do a gradient descent here?
For a single update, we need to some loss for all these 3 million data.
Right.
So that's very costly.
Yeah. So it will take a lot of time, because the number of samples that you have 3 million. So it has to, you know, to move from one step, to move from WK minus 1 to WK, it has to, you know, address all these 3 million points, then only it will move to this point, and this is the single step it will move after covering 3 million data. So this is the main drawback, and this is the reason why we are moving it to mini batch gradient descent. In mini batch gradient descent, what we do is we departition this existing data set into equal batches. So in this case, I am, for simplicity, taking 3000, and here I am taking 3 batches, x1, x2 and x3, as you can see here. So these batches are of equal size, and it contains 1000 samples. But if each of these samples, let us say, if you take only one sample in x1, one sample in x2, one sample in x3, then if x1, x2, x3 contains single data set, then it is called as stochastic gradient descent. So what it says is, instead of having 1000 samples in one batch, if you have only one sample in that batch, then we call it as a stochastic gradient descent. But if you have 1000 samples, then we call it as mini batch gradient descent. So pictorially, if you want to see this situation, then in this situation, what I am trying to show you is a situation of gradient descent. So this is a picture which is showing you a picture representation of gradient descent. So what it is saying is, you have all these batches that are formed, you are summing it up, you are creating a single batch X, you are feeding that X into this optimizer here with the alpha. Then what you are doing is, you are running through all these batches, then you move from W0 to W1. So it is taking one single step to reach to W1 once it went through all these 3000 samples. But in case of 3 million, it will be lot. That's why we are moving to batch gradient descent. So this is the situation in case of mini batch gradient descent. So here you can see what we are doing in mini batch gradient descent. In mini batch gradient descent, we have this weight, which I am writing it as W00. Here 0 is the epoch and this is the it is like this. So this is the batch you are addressing. So as you can see, initially we are at 00 location. Then what we are doing, we are feeding first batch, which is x1, with the learning rate alpha, and we are moving to this point now, which is 01. Here 0 is the epoch and 1 is the batch. So we are considering right now first batch. So this is the descent step, gradient descent step, which happens from W00 to W01. Then we are taking the second batch, X2, along with the learning rate alpha, and then we move from this to this point. And this is basically again showing you 2 here is the batch. This 2 is coming because you are using second batch to move from 01 to 02. And this 0 is the epoch because we are currently working on first epoch. Then again you are taking the pth batch and doing that same stuff to reach this point. And this complete step of moving from, you know, from the first point to the last is what we call as one epoch. So then you do multiple epochs of this to get the final answer. So in literature, actually in the research literature, what they have shown is after multiple epochs, so like, you know, if you go through this multiple times, these steps multiple times, then what you observe is that the gradient descent, the derivative of the weights with respect to the loss in case of batch gradient descent, that is simple gradient descent that we are using, becomes equal to the loss derivative of the loss with respect to weight in case of mini batch gradient descent. So both the derivatives become roughly equal. They are not exactly equal, but they have shown mathematically that if you do this multiple epochs, then they will both be giving you the same derivatives, which will give you the final optimum value, which is same. So this they have shown in the optimization literature. So if you want to see in picture, then it is something like this, which is happening here. The first one, this one, this curve is basically the gradient step that is happening in case of gradient descent, a typical gradient descent, whereas the bottom one, this one, is actually showing you the steps that are happening in case of mini batch gradient descent. And you can observe some more details here in terms of, you know, this is basically first epoch, this is second epoch, this is third epoch, this is fourth epoch. And now you can see how whatever we have discussed here in this case, like W01, then it is going to W02, then it is going to W0P. Now in this case, I am taking only 3 steps. So it is W01, W02 and W03. So it is meeting at the same point as the original gradient descent. So the epochs for this, see here, it will take billion images. It will take 3 billion images to move from this point to this point in case of gradient descent. But in this case, as you can see, from moving to this point, it is taking small number of images. And from here to here, again small number of images. From here to here, again small number of images. But when you sum these 3 images together, it will come out to be 3 million. So that's why stochastic gradient descent is fast, because it starts giving you results earlier. So ultimately what you observe here is that there is a zigzag pattern here. You can see it's a zigzag pattern. In this case of gradient descent, zigzag is there, but stochastic gradient descent makes it more zigzag. You can see now how noisy it is as compared to the original gradient descent. Here it is less, it is more noisy compared to this one. And one more thing that I observe here is that each of these the profiles, like, you know, they are random, like, you know, this will move like this, this is moving like this, this is moving like this, this is moving like this. So it's completely random. You cannot say it will go always down. It can go up or down depending upon how difficult that training data set is. Like, you know, if you consider this situation, why it is going up? This is going up because at this point, the batch that is given to this particular, you know, optimizer here is very difficult to train. That's why the error is going up. But in this situation, you can see it is going down. That means the batch that is allotted to this particular optimizer here at this point, at this current time, is easy to optimize. That's why the gradient descent is going down. So these profiles going up and down depends upon how difficult it is for them to actually optimize the particular batch. If it is difficult to optimize, the error will go up. If it is easy to optimize, the error will go down. But on an total, if you look at the complete profile, it will go down. So this is the case of stochastic gradient descent. And now you can see how this this is the case of mini batch gradient descent, not stochastic. So and then you can see how it is creating a more worse zigzag pattern as compared to the gradient descent. Any doubts here, please let me know. Otherwise, we will move forward. Okay, so if there is no doubts, then we will see the second problem in gradient descent. Because I was telling you, we have two problems, right? The first problem we have already discussed in detail, which is the zigzag problem. What is the second problem? The second problem is that the magnitude of the gradients can vanish rapidly near the stationary points. Like when you have stationary points, your vanishing gradients will the gradients will become zero, leading to the gradient descent to slowly crawl near the minima and saddle points. So at these type of points where we have minima and saddle points, your gradients will become close to zero. Because of that, your gradient descent will become very slow. And this problem, the one which we are discussing here, is very commonly happening in machine learning, where the functions we aim to minimize have long narrow valleys and flat areas. Normally, what we encounter in machine learning is some complex functions which are having very long narrow valleys and very flat areas. So this type of problem will be very common in that situation. So I will show you the picture here. So you can see these type of problems you will face in dealing with machine learning or deep learning situations. So here this problem is basically of flat areas. Here you have completely flat area, right? So the gradient descent or mini batch gradient descent will fail to reach to this minimum point. It will stop somewhere in between because the gradients at these points will be completely close to zero. And this is the point of situation when where we have saddle points. So these are saddle points. And in these points also, your minima, your optimizer will get stuck here. Because though it's a saddle point, it's not an optimal minima. This is the optimal one. So these are the situations. So to avoid this, one method was to use regularization, which we have discussed last time. That regularization will move this saddle point up and it will make it something like this to create a slope here. And the second thing is, if you are not using a regularizer, how to come up with the modified optimizer which will avoid these type of situations at the saddle point where your minima, where your optimizer is getting stuck here and it's not going here. So we have to see that. So this is the second problem. So two problems which you encounter in machine learning. And to give you a pictorial representation, here I am showing you the plot. This is the loss function of ResNet 50. And this is the loss function is for ResNet 10. And now you can see how complex the loss function profile is when you deal with these complex networks like ResNet, which we will discuss in the coming lectures. But these are the loss profiles for ResNet 50 and ResNet 110. I have taken it from this paper. If you want to study more, you can go into this paper, Visualizing the Loss Landscape of Neural Networks by Hayoli et al. So you can see from this paper And now what I am observing here is, in case of ResNet 110, you can see how flat this curvature is. So if your optimizer is starting from this point, then you all will agree that it will halt somewhere here itself, and it will not go down to this valley and stuck somewhere here. It will not do that. And same here also, see how many flat areas it has. This is also flat. Whereas in case of ResNet 50 also, we have flat areas somewhere here, but it has multiple saddle points also, like something like this, you know. It has some saddle points, but comparing to this architecture, to this, the flat areas in ResNet 110 is more, whereas in this case, it is less. But here you have a global optimum. This is the global optimum. So if your optimizer gets stuck at this point, it is the one of the best thing that it can do. But here you have no such global optimum. You have multiple local optima. So this is basically the loss function visualizations for your advanced networks. And you can see now how different. You can see that there are so many flat areas here, and it is seriously a problem, and we have to address this. So this is for today's lecture, and in the next lecture, what we will discuss is how to address these problems. So if you have any questions, we have 2 to 3 minutes. We can address that, and if not, then we can leave the class. Please let me know if you have any questions here regarding what we have discussed till now. Okay, then if you all have no problems, then we can leave the class, and now we will meet day after tomorrow. Okay, thank you so much.